To be honest, there is not. I picked these four men in particular, because, well, because I wanted to talk about genius and megalomania, and I want to talk specifically about, and from a male, very specifically about men, about this particular kind of man, and different kinds of men. And genius is often associated with men. This kind of genius is kind of there's a pride, and it's not all positive, you know. There's this like very sometimes almost destructive force running through it. And I picked these four honestly because they're touchstones for me. Like I feel connected to all four of these men in different ways, and so not always positively, but I feel connected to all of them. And so the truth is, no, I never, you know, I have the desire to talk about other people in other pieces, but it was always clear to me that this particular quartet, that it was four of them, and they interlock with each other well, and that they are actually arrayed in sort of ascending order of insanity. There was always really clear that these were the guys. They can change enormously. Especially a piece like Great Men of Genius hasn't been performed in 3 years. And so there's no way to rehearse because I don't rehearse without, there's no rehearsing without an audience. There's no one to tell, so there's no telling. So when I perform, I haven't walked down these roads in 3 years. So there's an enormous amount of shift. Things are shifting and moving continuously. In performance, and then you know that'll change. You know, like sometimes I'm in a run somewhere, like in the public in New York. You know, somewhere for a month or a month and a half or 2 months, doing it 8 times a week. It never becomes memorized in that classic way, but it does become very crystalline. You know, because you figure out exactly the beats of what you want to say. It tends to settle down over time, but we never lock it. We never freeze it. It continues to shift. Well, I don't know. I mean, I think it says something about the problems in the American theater and sort of the middle brow nature of the American theater that we're like even having this conversation, you know? I mean, it doesn't assert itself very often in stand up, you know? It doesn't assert itself in that arena. And I feel like the disconnect. I mean, and I even feel like the language of talking about the language is infantilizing. You know, people will say coarse language, people will say crude language. You know, the only one I'm willing to even use is adult language because I think it's the language that adults use. And if people are not willing to use adult language, if they would prefer to speak with child language, then you know they're children, and that's fine. Like if you want to live as a child, but if you are, you know, so ignorant that you're not able to handle this kind of language, then you know you should probably stay home. Like I'm, and I for one am very tired, and I don't have to deal with it much because, to be perfectly honest, you know, most of our work is in major cities along the coasts of America, so it hasn't been as much of an issue, you know. But coming into other communities, we try to like book into other communities. It's a very interesting thing. I think the fear of how language will be received is larger than the actual problems with language. It's the chilling effect that happens so often, you know, with freedom of speech and things. And so I actually think that the people's ability to handle, you know, language is much broader than people think that it's going to be. And I think it's really important to challenge people because one of the things that's exciting about unrestricted adult language is that, for one thing, it tends to be musical. It tends to have a beautiful music to it. It tends to use rhythm and repetition more than restricted language does. We tend to use explicatives as punctuation points and interjections and intermediaries to adjust the path of our language. And you lose a lot of that when you strip it out. But the thing that's most exciting about it is that it unsettles people. And to be willing to drop that from your arsenal, to say like, well, I'll use language, but I'll make sure I don't use any that unsettles anyone. It's a very compromised place to begin a conversation.
Okay.